And so, two things I want to talk about is starting with short motivation. Very interested in XTB, and especially XTB in the context of DFTB class. And a bit more about the extended pipeline itself, and finally some interesting situations, which is often related, but of course independent. So our motivation for developing XTB was that we usually have something like a multi-level workflow where we searching for some property which is determined by a few relevant structures. However, calculating this, finding those structures can be computationally expensive. So in this initial setup step, defining our search space, we start with 10,000 to maybe a million of candidate structures. And while we were previously mostly working with UT at those levels, those become unfeasible for the initial screen. So we so one group with Stefan Grimme, we were looking into extended binding for the fast method for initial screening, which then made it. And regarding development, this is a key development timeline for the XTB program. So we published the JP2 XTB in 2019, which kind of marks the start of open sourcing most of the XTB software. Initially starting, we put putting DFTB 4 on GitHub, starting with user documentation, codes. End of 2019, in the XTB program went open source, so it's compared to DFTB plus quite young. And from there on, we invested a lot in distribution, and also end of 2019, I got in touch with Paul M on the CTA meeting. And what eventually came out of this that we implemented DFTB 4 and DFTB plus. From there, I kind of stuck around with DFTB plus code base. In this is the next milestone for us, where we summarized the complete method development of XTB in a review. And this is a step observation I'm also talking about. In late 2022, late 2021 was XTB finally introduced. And compared to DFTB Plus, I just took this snapshot today. We're doing quite okay. We're not, we're still not on the same level of contributors as DFTB Plus, but it's taking up.
So what?
What are we doing? So we'll give a basic introduction about type finding theory again, but without formulas this time. So as you know from Barnes' talks, basic starting point is DFT, but what we're doing is looking at the difference between the atomic system, a molecule, and all the atoms. So we only have to look into valence electron properties to simplify the system we're looking at. And what we want is, with the type binding, not to do this rigorous reconstruction which we have to do density function type binding, but find an approach where we can do this in a parametric way, to include all relevant physics. And this context compared to density function type binding, extended type binding is more empirical, or we would call it more flexible in a way. So with this in mind, we want to have a parametric model which we are looking into. At first, we start with defining what we actually want to have a parametric state. Hi, Thomas. So I'm just taking over from you.
Yeah, that's fine.
So, in contrast to density type binding, with extended type binding, we explicitly want to limit our parameterization targets. So, we are mainly aiming for a special purpose method, which we are grouping under the GFN family, which I will explain a bit what this acronym stands for. And our main targets are usually structural properties. We want to have this in multi-level workflow for optimizing initial ensembles. We also want to have vibration frequencies because we want to characterize those. We want to obtain free energies from the force evaluation which we're doing. And another thing, since we're interested in big systems, is that for those non-covalent actions become reversed. And means we will want to have something which can do non-covalent actions well. And this includes something like this bucket catcher molecule layer, dispersion interactions, but also hydrogen halogen bond. And one of the key features of DFTB, while it's generally parameterizable, is that there are few parameterizations which cover a lot of chemical space. And usually, when we're doing chemistry and have experimental collaborators, they're doing a lot of transition metal chemistry, maybe heavy main groups. So we have to make a cut somewhere, and we decided to make this cut greater, so we cover most of the chemical space, not all of the relevant ones, but most of those which we are usually here. Next thing, now that we have defined that our method should be good at, we're looking at the ingredients which we want to put in. So this is now especially tailored for GM2XDB. So we want to capture all the relevant interactions. And the cool thing about type binding is that we basically can look into each part and put them together as good, so make them individually as good as possible and put them together. And what we do similar to DFTB is we of course have an effective Hamiltonian. We are not tabulating, but we are expanding in a Gaussian base set. So we can define these integrals directly. And of course, we get like DFTB eccentric pattern version from the overlap. And of course, bonding from our effect Hamiltonian. Additionally, we're also using this additional repulsion term. In our case, we are approximating for this the repulsion of screen charges, so of nuclear atoms at those distances. So it's more like a damped Coulomb interaction. And finally, when we are going into charge separation formalism, which we are deriving the DFTB from, we are expanding this charge, this density fluctuations in a multiple scheme and truncating it at quadrupoles. So we get anisotropic, and this allows us to capture effects like hydrogen and halogen bonding. And further, of course, there's London dispersion, which is important if we are going to large systems. And there we have effects that are highly dependent on the local environment. We also need to account for higher order couplings. So This is the DFTB effort we did. So the main things which we then developed in this context on top of our original our first approach to extended type binding was to introduce this multiple electrostatics and create the self-consistent dispersion correction based on what we have in the DFTB format. And we named it GFN2XDB because we just put in the main features we are parameterizing it for was geometry, frequency, non-covalent actions. And so far, there are only three codes available which implement GFN2XDB. So this is the XDB program for our group. Now DFTB Plus is available as well, and there's a full GPU implementation, TerraCam, which I think is only lacking the deepwater version, but otherwise complete. And all other programs which implement GFN2XDB are usually interfacing XDB. There are a few implementations of GFN1, but all other are based on either of those three. So one thing we decided is that we want to have some of the physical limits. We want to break bonds and not run into problems like static correlation, which means we turn on electronic temperature by default to a reasonable amount, which allows us to basically dissociate almost everything. So the usual example you would see is the N2 dissociation when many of the methods fail. And of course, we don't get the dissociation limit right, but at least we can dissociate it without breaking. And this offset is somewhat systematic, but not one dissociation energies aren't really a target for XDBs. We can see here is dissociation curve, some diatomic molecules. And here you see an experimental or high level theory reference. And from also, it looks quite okay. Some we are off, which, at least for nitrogen, is mainly due to the warm spin states we get if, in restricted formalism, which we're using with final electronic temperature. Other thing. As I mentioned, the structural properties are main target for XDB, the XDB parameterization we have. Here's one example, this benchmark of experimental rotation and constants, which give a good description of the geometry as a whole. And we compare to one reasonably good DFT, which is R2Scan-D4, which I put in here. And if you compare the methods I tested with all the semi-empirics I got my hands on at this time, you see that the GFN2XDB is produced a bit too large molecules, but overall a reasonable error spread, which is almost comparable to what we would get with a density functional method. And of course, we are about 2 to 3 orders of magnitude faster than a meta GGA, with our DFT method is, which we are comparing against. These are the organic molecules we compare against. So this is well into the applicability also of the DFTB methods, which you can see here. They have a bit larger spread, but if you compare them, like DFTB3, which is comparable theory to GFN1XDB from the approximation level, you see also similar error spread. So introducing higher order multiples in our scheme has a reason to do it. Next thing that's interesting is non-covalent actions, and there. We're looking to larger systems. This is supramolecular association benchmark set, which we collect in our group, where we have several different motives. Like this association reaction there, you can see a London dispersion driven complex. This is buckyball catcher. you also have, as you see down here, halogen or hydrogen bonding motors, which you want to describe. So this are common motors which we would have to model working with our experimental colleagues. So this is important to get them right or good enough with our with the XTB method. More than reasonably. Also, you see here something like iodine, fluorine here, some of these compounds, which can be modeled by most of the DFTB methods, except for this one, we have to drop those. Unfortunately, especially the halogen bonding is usually not bound in density function type binding, also, sometimes not in, in the PM methods. But with DFTB, this seems to be right. Of course, we have a much larger error range for this system here, about 19 kilojoule per mole in error here, which you can compare to reasonably good performing DFT, which is around 40 kilojoules per mole. But for the speed up, we're getting quite. And the final thing, also want to show you things that do not work with XTB or not work well. And this would be an example of thermochemistry. So we didn't really put much weight in picking thermochemistry, but it's difficult to get right if you want to get geometries. So we're looking at metal organic reaction energies here for several. Modern reactions from typical inorganic chemistry, also catalytic relevant species, which cover most the transition metals, C-block elements. And this is more or less an off-target property for most of the XTB parameterization. And you see that scale. So previously it was going from minus 150 to 150, now it's going from minus 400 to 400 to get at least the inner boxes of the box plots of the other methods we're trying to compare against. So it's not performing that great anymore. It's not a complete failure, but it certainly doesn't work well. So this is something which we usually can't do with XTB, and I think also with DFTB, this is complicated to do to get thermochemistry right. Then we usually have to resort to the similar barrier, but at least we can provide a reasonable guess if at the XTB level. Yeah, finally, if you want to do modeling, another aspect. Which we're interested in is free energies. And if you compare the association energies to compute with the association free energies the experimentalists measure for those compounds, you see that we are missing some contribution. And this contribution can be quite large. And we know how to describe this partly. So if we have this association energy, we need to include these correction terms. And some of those are thermostatistic contributions, which are on topic for our XTB parameterizations, because we want to get frequencies right. But there are also summation effects, which come into play, because all those are measured in a condensed phase, surveyed in some solvent. So one way to do this is to do this explicitly. However, if you do it explicitly with type binding, you can do this because system you're still fast. But of course, you have more degrees of freedom. You need to think about how to sample this. And it will significantly increase the computational cost. So one option to do this is to look into implicit solvation models. And this allows us to include solvation effects basically at no additional cost or an additional cost into our type binding. And what we have now in DFTB Plus is non-polar contribution, which we do when we transfer our system from the gas phase to the solvent phase. And we have polar contribution if we solve the system with the dielectric boundary conditions. If you want to get the solvation contribution, you of course have to calculate the system also in the gas phase. Then you can make the difference between those two. So subtract the vacuum energy at the solvation energy, and then we get the difference how to transfer the system from the gas phase into the solvation phase. And what the model we came up here is a analytical linearized solution of the Poisson-Boltzmann equation, which is more or less based on generalized Born theory, but at finite dielectric constant rather than infinity. And we made this for type binding methods in general, so also for DFTB, and this readily available. All right. Here's an example where we have a cationic dimer, which found experimentally to be bound. Here it's even more drastic. If you calculate the theory at a really high level, let's say we would get a value at coupled cluster theory, then we would say this is unbound by 37 kilojoules per mole. If you calculate those from statistical corrections, calculate those at DFT level, then you would get additional 70 kilojoules per mole, say this is still unbound. If you calculate the solvation contribution with GFN2XDD, this fits rather nicely, and you get a qualitatively bound state reproducing the refined experiment. All right. So if we now do this a bit more rigorous, then just an example where we have apparently very a much too nice fit. We can also see that if we compare against the best available solvation model for EFT, that we are getting into the right range with all the methods. So also DFTB 2 and 3, as well as GFN2XDB, get into the right dimension of errors regarding those solvation energies for those reactions. Bit of what are things which we can't do with XDB, so it's not solved at the moment. So we still a set consistent model similar to DFTB, and we haven't really found a way to make it cheap. So we can go much further, make a force field, throw out the Hamiltonian part. But then, of course, you lose the possibility to form box, which is rather important usually. And on the other hand, we still only have two parameterizations, which are for this geometry frequency non-coherent action part. And our parameterization is unfortunately only available to molecular systems. So you can run periodic calculations with this. But if you have a hard or ionic solid, then the results are expected to be poor. So you can think about it the same way. If you have the free UV parameterization of DFTB, you wouldn't use this for describing titanium dioxide. So you would do something else. And this is kind of what we're hoping tech in the future, now that XDB is integrating DFTB Plus, we still want to have all the features. Which are also available in this framework, and there are a lot of possibilities. You could getting access to the hybrids, getting integrated with CDA creation, or having electron transport based, which would open up a lot of new elements to investigate. And also, which would be really cool is if we can get a parameterization which is more tailored for material science. Those are around for DFTB, but not yet for XTB. And also, maybe provide a framework which makes it easier to develop custom parameterizations. So with that, I'm basically done. Also, I have to acknowledge a lot of people because it's not all my work alone. My boss, Stefan Wimmer, for supporting me and letting me do all this amazing work together with the DSU Plus community. Christoph Bannwart, who worked with me together on the GFA2 XTB and now got his professorship in Aachen, and of course, Barn Ben for introducing me to DSU Plus. Also, also from the side of the side of all people, Larry Barnes, for introducing me here to the software package managing, which brought eventually DFTB Plus to come. That's from my side. Any questions?